Swinburne University of Technology.
Welcome everyone to today's CAIA seminar, and extending a warm welcome to everyone who's come who's not from Swinburne, who's come from outside. So thank you very much for coming. Today's speaker is David Fulger from Netflix. David's been the Director of Content Delivery Architecture at Netflix for 3 years. Before joining Netflix, he worked in the CDN group at Level 3 Communications, and Savvis and Cable and Wireless. He's an Australian boy, grew up in Canberra. Commiserations. studied astrophysics at ANU. today, David's going to be talking to us about OpenConnect, which is a global delivery network built for delivery, presumably Netflix video, across the world. So thank you very much for coming, David.
Great.
The floor's all yours.
Thanks very much. So before I start, I'm guessing most people know what Netflix is as a service. Yes? No? No, absolutely. That's why I'm asking the question. How many people know what content delivery networks are? How many people have no idea what a content delivery network is? Okay, fine. I only have a few slides here. I want to try and make it interactive. Feel free to put your hand up, ask a question. Should go much more interestingly if we do that. The slides I've got actually are from a talk I gave a few months ago, which was sort of like an annual talk we give at a conference in New York. So we sort of started out indicating, you know, why Netflix internet traffic is interesting, in particular for service providers, and why it is an interesting content delivery network. The project started 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago, something like that. Netflix has been a streaming service over the internet since 2007. Before that, only domestically in the US was it a DVD delivery service. But the streaming service is now like an order of magnitude bigger than the DVD service ever got to. And all our international expansion, initially it was Canada, then through the rest of the US, Central and South America, and then all through Europe, has been a streaming-only service. And it's a very successful service, and it's a subscription-based service. You pay a monthly fee rather than a transactional fee per title, and that allows you to watch streaming video, TV series, and movies on a wide variety of devices. And the interesting thing is, after a few years in every market we've operated in, we start to become like a dominant form of traffic. In nearly all cases, surpassing sort of YouTube traffic, which is typically otherwise the dominant form of traffic. And perhaps also interestingly, more than the what appears to be declining global peer-to-peer traffic, especially in markets like Scandinavia, where that level of traffic used to be relatively high fractionally, is now going down. And so Netflix is typically in the 30% to 50% of downstream traffic to residents. A lot has been made that we're a third of the internet in the US. That's actually, depending on how you define what internet is or where internet congestion is, of course that's not true. We make up very small numbers of bits actually on internet backbones. But this is the amount of traffic that is in consumer residential broadband. Anyhow, so we've built this network initially. I guess the first year Netflix had their own content delivery network, it became apparent in, 07, 08, that the vendor or third-party CDN market, companies like Level 3 and Akamai and Limelight, were going to provide a really interesting service. So Netflix moved all their traffic to a combination of those. At the end, in 2011, we were the largest by bit delivery customer of each of those three, and at that point the scale of the Netflix traffic made a lot of sense from a scale point of view to bring that traffic in-house, because we now have a network that's as big as any of those networks. So this summer, in northern summer, we actually now have all our traffic on our own network. and that means where many terabits of traffic. Every single evening is the interesting thing. It's not spiky traffic. Monday through Thursday are nearly always the same sort of traffic levels. Friday through Sunday, slightly elevated traffic, but that's a weekly cycle. We don't see, even for our most popular releases, we see very small incremental amounts of traffic. But we do notice things like, you know, large sporting events in the US when there's a Super Bowl, we'll see a decline in traffic. We'll see people starting to watch again at halftime, and then they go, depending on the quality of the game, they'll either come back for the second half or they'll just start watching at the end. And I guess that's an awful lot of people just have the one TV and they're just switching the input. The team over the last 3 years, this is actually more than a year old, but is about 50 people that are directly related to the CDN group. About half of them are software engineers working either in control plane software or the firmware and hardware group. The other half are a relatively small group of people running operations and then a larger group of people running network engineering and network operations, so discussions with various networks around the world. I should mention Ken Florence, who runs the group, is also with us, so all the tricky questions I'll punt to him. I just want to give you a little bit of background about Netflix. It's about 1,700 people apparently now. More than 1,000 of those employees are engineers. Nearly all of them are based in Los Gatos, which is sort of suburban San Jose in Silicon Valley. It's a very sort of centralized corporate culture, except for our group. And our group has people in all crazy places, including at Swinburne with Lawrence. We have someone else, another colleague of Lawrence's works from Adelaide. We have a bunch of people in different states across the US. And it's sort of an experiment for Netflix to see whether we can do remote working. So as mentioned earlier, the service runs on at least a couple of thousand different types of products now, anything from cell phones, set-top boxes, you know, set-top box types, video sticks, game consoles, tablets, and then you know, a bunch of those devices are connected to TVs. Some TVs have internet capability, and in nearly all cases in major markets, the Netflix app is one of the ones that consumer electronics companies like to have loaded. We see a wide variety of usage across all those devices. I would say the only interesting thing that we notice in mobile usage is we're seeing more and more people watch on cell phones and tablets, but in most cases that's when they have Wi-Fi from some fixed broadband rather than actually watching on cell data networks. I think a lot of that is due to the length of Netflix content is at least like a TV show, so if you take all the ads out, that's about 20 minutes long. Up to a movie length, and so it's not sort of snack video content like YouTube. So these were promotional pictures trying to indicate how ubiquitous we want to be. So it's family watching on TV, kid comes home and watches Netflix, but watches a different show. And then you go to the office and you keep watching Netflix. Then you go to the park and you keep watching Netflix. And you go to bed and you keep watching Netflix. So this is really the end goal of our product. You're allowed to like go to sleep, but beyond that, you should have a screen and be watching Netflix. And so there's a lot of product features in terms of making the service as personalized as possible. This is like a home screen. And every single subscriber, including as a subscriber, you can get to set up different profiles for different members of the household. It's trying to make a selection of the catalog, what we call merchandise, but as a subscription service, you don't pay as such for each of these services, but it's sort of like a shop. We're trying to sell you different titles, which we think you'll be interested in watching next. And the overall goal of the product team is to use a whole bunch of personalization algorithms to, when you start Netflix up, you fire it up, you know, you've signed in, and it should almost just start playing that amazing title that was the thing you really wanted to watch without you realizing. At the moment, that doesn't quite work that way, so you get a bunch of choices in a ranked list, and that's how the service operates. But then if you're watching a series on one device, you can pick it up on another device, etc. We also have, it being a subscription service, there's no advertising. It's also very popular for families using it for their kids. And so what I wanted to do is give you a little bit of background about how the service operates from the video display point, video streaming point of view, and then go into some detail about how we built the CDN, and hopefully that'll start some questions. So since the service started in 2007, that was early days of different vendor solutions for adaptive HTTP delivery. At the time, I think the majority of video delivery on the internet was Adobe Flash, which was sort of a broken proprietary protocol. Broken in terms of mass scaling, it required a bunch of proprietary servers that were really built for a totally different interactive sort of gaming purpose, and they had video capabilities bolted onto it, so CDNs found that hard to scale. But there was a huge advantage in going to HTTP. You know, web pages typically work when you get an internet service of any kind, and so it enabled a proliferation of different connections working about as well as they can. The HTTP overhead for the large files we use is not really all that significant, and it's all on-demand content, so all our clients have significant buffers on the client side, and so we're not really trying to do live TV. We don't have any live content. And so it's a great methodology for that. And the adaptive component is we're pre-computing a bunch of sort of stepped different bit rates, and the clients will try and guess the right one, and often to give you a nice fast experience, we'll guess a relatively low, educated guess, a relatively low bit rate, and then as they notice you've got more bandwidth available, they'll ramp up to a higher pitch quality. And depending on which bit of content it is, we have a majority of our content in high definition, so that's up to 1080p encodes. Not all devices support that. And then for a very limited subset of content, we have all the way up to 4K encodes, which is, again, limited set of content, very limited set of devices. And those highest bit rates are about 15 megabit for the video. But the highest HD content is typically in the 5 to 6 megabit range. So the interesting aspect of what we're trying to do is if you think about the Netflix client as it's Netflix code either through an SDK or directly as a native client or as an HTML5 application, it's running our own adaptive bitrate heuristics, trying to choose the right bitrate for that particular connection with a whole bunch of client metrics. And to get information about whether this subscriber is paid up customer, what sort of UI they need to see, what sort of recommendations they're going to see, and when they start streaming, what servers on our delivery network they use, we're using a control plane connection up into a cloud service, and Netflix uses three different locations of Amazon's web services platform for that. And so part of my group is building software that the client are talking to and getting a bunch of that information. And so when they press play on a particular item, what we're trying to do is use a bunch of knowledge about where that client is on the internet, what our caching infrastructure is around that, and choose the right primary option, and then always have a secondary and a tertiary option as well. And that means that during the play, if there's any issues with an initial option, the client can, without having to go and talk to anyone else or get other information, can decide to use a backup or a backup to that backup. And in the worst case scenario, if all of those fail, it'll go and try and re-qualify itself and get a whole new bunch of options. Makes an incredibly reliable system, and there's a bunch of other shortcuts we take because we have this control channel. There's a lot of content delivery traffic that's actually sent using a DNS trick. So when you have a particular bit of content, it'll have a domain name and it'll use knowledge about where that domain name is resolved in the internet infrastructure to give you a nearby cache for that. And so when you want to try and use CDN for a web page, that's typically the best methodology for that. For us, we already have this control connection before we hand off the video URL. And so we actually encode the IP address directly of the end server. We get rid of DNS altogether. It's just one more component in the system that we don't have to see breakage with. So the interesting thing about building a content delivery network for this single purpose versus other sorts of more generic content delivery networks is not only do we have a particular type of content, but we have this sort of fixed library. And so instead of doing an on-demand cache, which is how like an Akamai cache would operate, or actually it's how a YouTube cache operates, where clients are sent to the cache and the cache either has it, in which case it can serve it out, might have it, it's not sure whether it's the right copy, it'll go and check and then send it out, or if it doesn't have it, it'll fill, send out to the client and store a copy depending on certain caching rules. In our scenario, it's a much simpler process. We use a pre-populated sort of rank list of our statistical guesstimate of the best content to have for a particular unit of storage on the network. And we use off-peak times when networks are less busy to fill those caches in advance. And so historically, when we started, we were just using like the previous day in a sort of decayed methodology. Now we actually use some of the new release knowledge that we have about how the user interface is going to try and display new titles available to users to actually pre-populate caches in advance of their popularity, if that makes sense. So the other interesting thing about the caching network is basically have two different types of install with a common set of hardware across those two types of install. When we first started the project, we thought it was just going to be additive to our existing delivery, third-party delivery. And we developed this cache that would be very effective for service providers that wanted to have Netflix content within their network and reduce that sort of middle mile traffic. But since then, we now are carrying all our traffic, but we use the same physical hardware, typically in racks in large exchange locations, to serve that traffic to everyone. And then the service providers that don't want to peer with us at the locations we have can take caches to augment and further reduce costs. So this is a log graph of library size. To give you an idea, a total content library is over 2 petabytes of content. So it's not a huge library compared with a large social media site. But the interesting thing is all titles across that catalog get viewed on a daily basis. We have, I think, 53 million subscribers was the last quarterly number. And we have enough viewing across all those bits of content. Because it's not social media and people's uploaded photos, we don't see the sort of rapid popularity of initial uploads and then the sort of decaying away of someone's cat video 2 or 3 years later. So it's a constantly refreshed library of professionally made content, and because of that, the viewing is very deep within the catalog, and the personalization that's so sort of intrinsic in the service also means that no two people at a particular cache, typically watching the same content at the same bit rate in the same sort of time window to enable things like memory caching to be all that effective. So we rely an awful lot on having a very efficient system to take content off hard drives, which are the most efficient way of holding a small volume of traffic to offload onto network interfaces. And that's the primary box that we use, and I'll show you details of that in a minute. And then in locations that we have a very large amount of traffic, we can justify putting flash-only devices. And each of those devices, or basically, if you think about it, that only at the very largest concentrations of traffic do we generate enough demand on a particular title to make that title worthwhile to have on the fast throughput of a flash device versus on spinning drive. But the economics of that is slightly better for us in those locations. So again, talked a little bit about this idea of proactive caching rather than on-demand caching. If you did Netflix content on demand, even if you were very clever about it, it's very hard to know that just because someone in a particular area has watched a bit of content that it's likely to, for a second person to watch it, versus we're keeping statistics across the entire catalog usage. And so it's much easier for us to be able to work out that the highest level of content offload selection. So a little bit about these appliances. They're PC servers. They're made out of commodity hardware components. There's a couple of things that aren't the sorts of components that most people are making their home PCs out of, which is a little unfortunate because the economics don't work as well for us. But as much as possible, we're trying to build servers that use components, and those components are really the scale of the usage and manufacture of those components is in some other industry, ideally consumer electronics, where the scale is much larger and we can benefit from that scale. If we were buying components that were solely made for us or the server industry in general, they're typically much more expensive components. So we have these two different types of servers. Really, the goal when we're building a server within an ISP is we provide them a server, we want to make it as compact as possible, use as little power as possible so the space and power requirements are low, we want to produce the largest offload. And so a large amount of spinning drives in a box, looking like this, is the most effective way to do it. So this is a 4U box, it's a little over sort of the sort of size in height, about 2 foot deep, and it has 36 of the highest capacity drives we can buy. They're sort of jammed in there each time. And we use a little bit of flash in these devices as well to offload the most popular content and keep the operating system. In the front, we actually turn the server back to front in this case, and so all the connections are in the front like a bit of networking equipment. And in the front, we'll have 2x10, sometimes 4x10 interfaces, network interfaces. And so they're one of the aspects that aren't a commodity server as such, but that's the sort of optical interface that ISPs have that we can then connect the server into. But really quite a compact device. It does weigh 50 kilos, so it's not a light device. But that's primarily just the weight of the hard drives. If you take those out, it's a pretty small amount of internal equipment. And really, an ISP should be able to rack it, plug in the power, plug in the network port, and it's good to go. It's not a complicated caching setup with top-of-rack switches and a bunch of different servers in different roles. It's a single unit. I touched on earlier that in these sites where we have like a terabit of traffic, we can change the storage components to be flash only. We basically keep the rest commodity. We use a faster processor to deal with a larger sort of transactional volume of individual streams. And then we use a 2-port 40 gig NIC, of which only one port is ever connected. And that way, depending on the day of the week, the development team will either be able to get 30 gigs out of it, or 20 gigs out of it, or 30 gigs out of it, or 20 gigs out of it. In fairness, it's one of those things, you know, because the clients are adaptively changing their bit rate, they're on different types of connections, you know, everything from a small amount on cell networks, a bunch of people on DSL. Around the world, probably the majority of people are using cable, and then there's some people on fiber. Those different sorts of devices have different, typically average bit rates, and that does affect the throughput that the servers have, depending on whether they're CPU limited or I/O limited. This is a much more commodity box in terms of we don't have to use a custom chassis here, it's an off-the-shelf chassis. Still use redundant power supplies. Sort of the interesting thing over this project is I've been building these sort of boxes for a decade. Early on, you would always worry that hard drives would fail, sort of like 5 up to 10% annual failure rate. The last couple of years' generation of hard drives are failing at much, much lower rates, which is great, and it's one less thing to worry about with hard drives. The bigger issue there is because more and more consumer electronics don't use hard drives anymore. That market is diminishing rapidly. There's very little innovation. There's really only two companies left that make hard drives. And they're just shoring up their market. They're not really putting a large amount of new development into that area. So we've sort of seen a plateauing of the evolution of hard drives, but fortunately flash is, you know, a very competitive marketplace, and we see year on year improvements in the economics of that, that I think within about 3, certainly 5 years, we won't be buying hard drives anymore. There'll be flash everywhere. Tell you a little bit about the system stack of software we use. So on the appliances, one of the decisions we made early on, and this is really from the experience of a few people on the team, that if you try and run these appliances like servers, and you think about the stack as like there's an operating system layer, there's certain application layer, and then there's sort of like a management layer of software running on it. And you get all very clever about, you know, having different flavors of different servers and different configurations. You soon get to the scenario that, without wanting to tell tales on my previous employer, at level three we had, at one point, say 3,000 servers, and we had about 2,500 different configurations on those 3,000 servers. So from an operational point of view, it was always sort of like whack-a-mole trying to work out which combination in which location wasn't as good. And level three certainly improved that, but at Netflix, because we were sort of this greenfield approach, we decided that although there would be some downsides in doing so, we would think about the software stack running on the caches much more like consumer electronics do, and they just have a single firmware. And so that means, you know, down to the script level, we try and bundle stuff up on a release schedule and send it out and then roll that out in the network. So from an operations point of view, there's typically like there's the new one and the old one, but there's not 15 different varieties of all of those. That said, you know, different machines have different roles and there is some configuration that happens, but it's not because they're loaded with different versions of software, and I think that does solve a bunch of problems. And we now have 3,000 or 4,000 servers, and we have a very small operations team managing that set of servers. I'll talk a little bit more about the firmware later, but certainly be able to answer any questions about it. And then we have this control plane service, which is all hosted on cloud services. And really there's two main components of that. One is the logic that uses client access logs and some of this predictive behavior of how we think users are going to consume new content to position the content on the set of servers we have. So there's a whole group that works on that infrastructure. And then there's a second one, which we call the steering aspect of things, which is basically when a client says, hey, I want to watch this bit of content, we need to know which servers have it, are they healthy at the moment, and are they appropriate to hand back to this particular client. And so those two services operate in what we call a control plane. Then we have an operational portal. We make a version of that available to our partners so they can see aspects of the server infrastructure that they're hosting, and they can make some changes to that in the future. We also had some monitoring and then an extensive set of reporting. So even before we were running our own CDN, all our clients would send back usage information about the quality of the experience, the bitrate they were showing, and various network bits of information. And so that all comes back for every single play. So there's, you know, many millions of simultaneous streams, and all that data comes back. You know, we can then slice and dice it by application type, by network, I mean, by device type on the client side, whether it's a game console or a tablet, the sort of content they're watching and the viewing pattern. So a little bit more about this firmware that we're running on the devices. We use FreeBSD for underlying operating system, and we have a bunch of people on staff that have deep knowledge about that to try and optimize drivers and network interfaces. And then the application stack, we're using Nginx, which is great, relatively lightweight web server. It also does way more things than we really need. We have a very simple set of use case, and we're really just trying to do one thing. We also use some BGP routing software, not in the common way that people would use it to actually move packets around. This is really just a way for ISPs to signal to us in a way that sort of they're comfortable with and it's native to them. The set of net blocks in particular that they want associated with a particular cache. And we actually use some BGP syntax to enable them to actually create a hierarchy there. And so they can go and advertise certain net blocks to a particular cache. They could take those away when they want to drain traffic and do some maintenance. They can have different hierarchies between different cities of caching infrastructure. But on our side, we're not actually moving the bits around on the cache based on that routing daemon. We're just taking that information, we package it up, and we send it into our control plane, and that goes into the algorithm that's choosing appropriate caches for end users. And then we have a bunch of custom scripts that basically talk to this control plane, a bunch of other things. I think that's most of what I had. So hopefully that's enough information to give you a taste of what we do in the group, what the project's about, and stimulate some questions if you have any.
Thank you very much, Dave. Any questions for that?
Sure.
So you just have one copy of all of the data that has been pushed through a server, and you're transcoding that in real time, or do you have multiple copies taking up space on those 36 disks?
Yeah, so we've looked at this, and it's better for us to do the encode in advance, and we actually do that in some of the cloud infrastructure. And it's pre-encoded by the time it comes to the server in all the different bit rates. So this problem was actually more significant 3 or 4 years ago when the client teams, their main goal was to be able to release a platform as soon as we knew something about a new device. And sometimes the technology choices that vendor had made meant that we would have to have a particular type of filing code. Now, we're more dominant in the market, the market's more mature, there's more obvious standard sets of encodes, and so we've pretty much brought, I think at this point, nearly everything onto a single set of encodes. And that means there's still one for every different bit rate we have, so we have up to 25 different files for a particular title. But to do the best quality of this, it's all pre-programmed material rather than live material. To do the best quality encode on it, we do that in a way that we probably couldn't do without a lot more CPU, certainly at the quality levels that we have and the sort of encode recipes, sometimes they're multipass, et cetera, that are trying to get sort of the best quality on the disk size. So. Yeah, if we had a slightly different problem and we were trying to deliver Netflix content to like only 100 users, then it might make more sense to have a smaller disk footprint and do some transcoding on the fly. But you know, the smallest box we have serves you know more than 10,000 streams, and if it was trying to do any transcoding on that at all, it'd fall over pretty quickly.
I wouldn't
say it was negligible, but the reality is we've DRM'd the content using a variety of different industry technologies there. That's a requirement of when we acquire the content. It's not a choice we deliberately make as such. And because of that, for people that wanted to obtain the content some other way, there's a lot of easier ways to do it than try and break DRM schemes, etc. And so anyone who's then trying to download content, we make some attempt to try and stop people doing it, but if they really wanted to, they could, but it's sort of useless bits, so I'm guessing they just grow bored of it and stop doing it.
You mentioned having moved content delivery from the cloud to your own.
Well, when I meant cloud, I meant not cloud as in an Amazon Compute cloud or a Google cloud, more like third-party vendors, so like Akamai service, CDN service. There's certainly nothing at the moment that we would plan to do. If you think about the amount of compute we do, even by doing this pre-encoding of the content that we get in this really large mezzanine files and try and get the best quality copies at different bit rates, all the heuristics that we're running and all the personalization algorithms to try and give you top choices, all that compute for even 50 million subscribers and all the website infrastructure is a relatively small amount of compute versus the amount of compute that exists in third-party cloud services. So when you're a small fish in a big sort of market, that's very efficient for us then to be able to pay someone a reasonable amount of money, and they have the efficiency of scale on that. On the CDN side, because we're so large compared with all the vendors we would choose, no one vendor could solve all our problems right now, and so that's why it was more obvious to bring it in-house. The other reason was, around the world we have somewhat contentious relationships with certain ISPs for various reasons. Some of it is we have a large amount of traffic, some of it is they've got competing products, some of it is they've built a network that they like to advertise at downstream 20 megabit, but they much prefer not that users didn't actually use it anywhere near that level. And so by using a third-party CDN, Netflix was able to have those conversations, but sort of had a third party doing the actual execution on it, and the third party always is not necessarily totally aligned with either the ISP's best interest or, in our case, the content provider's best interest. So by having our own CDN, we can have those conversations, we can make compromises, make changes in the way we do design on the ISP's benefit, and we can execute on it immediately because we're in full control of that infrastructure. Less important on the compute side, the number of bits, it's way less than 1%. So it's just in the noise.
Hi. David Wilder from Arnex. The ISP that connects all of the universities around Australia. Mm-hmm. I was interested in potential huge volumes of traffic that could be descending upon the network.
Sure.
Well, I don't know how much...
Students never watch Netflix based on our experience. So I've got a little story before you ask your question, which is early on we thought when we first had our caches that, and I live in Boulder, Colorado, big university town, that if we went to a university, especially a bunch of universities in the US have first year residents on campus, we thought, oh, there's a bunch of usage there. We'll go and ask the IT department if they want to take one of our caches as a sort of experiment. It'd be sort of a lot of fun. It turns out that even the very large universities don't really generate that much traffic. Even the University of Colorado has 30,000 students. Unfortunately, they just don't watch enough Netflix to really justify it. Typically, we put in caches when the broadband subscription base is sort of like 100,000 users. That justifies having a cache in a particular area. But while we were looking through this data, we thought we'll look at like some fancy university, like I think it was MIT, versus some state university. I can't even remember which one it was. It wasn't Colorado. It wasn't in California. And look at what the usage pattern was coming up through finals. And the best thing was at MIT, it just kept on going up. And the state university, it totally dived. Like, no one at State University is watching Netflix. So it's not exactly how you would think, but I guess the MIT guys were multitasking a lot. Sorry, what was your question?
Well, they didn't need to.
Yeah.
Procrastination patterns or something.
Exactly.
Actually, I was just interested to know, I don't know whether we're going to see an enormous amount of Netflix traffic. It depends on residential kind of patterns and such like too, but certainly over time we see 50% of year-on-year growth of traffic, except when YouTube kicked off and we suddenly saw a massive spike. So I could imagine we'd see something like that from Netflix, or it could be further down the track when you've got more content that's sort of education focused.
Yeah, so we're currently in like 70 countries, so we've seen the pattern of our growth, and every single one of those countries has been successful over some period of time. So it's more a matter of, so far, our track record is it's more a matter of when. And you know, some we see sort of overnight sensation, a lot of people using it straight away. Others, it's a slower growth.
So Phil, what I was going to ask, and you've kind of touched on it, is you've got your own network pushing stuff out and then peering into exchanges, and
yep.
then you've got caches spread out.
Right.
What sort of ratio of traffic gets served up off your own sort of infrastructure as
sure.
opposed to the caches which are spread out across service provider network?
Sure. It's a great question. And it really depends on different markets around the world. So some of the markets in Europe, I think now we probably have more traffic off embedded caches than we do out of the exchanges. And it's interesting, I think a lot of that is just due to the length of time we're in the particular country, and so our traffic's grown to a certain level. The competitiveness of ISPs, sometimes regulatory pressures that cause them not to want to cooperate more than anything else. The health of the exchange community that we're going into, a bunch of different dynamics. And then there's some cases where, you know, 100% of the traffic for a particular country, especially some of the smaller countries, is being delivered through peering. So that ratio just changes. And it seems to evolve as well. You know, if you think about if you're running an ISP, have a whole bunch of customers, you know, you're not quite sure whether this Netflix thing's going to take off on your in your territory, you can start with a peering arrangement. As it becomes more obvious that, hey, I could save some money in the middle mile, then you could take a cache. And that works out fine for us too. So it's just, again, because the hardware is the same, there's no advantage as such from nearly any other metric in terms of, you know, performance or anything like that. It's more a matter of some mutual saving of costs at that point.
Even with 36 disks,
yep.
obviously you don't have enough space to store everything, especially when you've got all those
yep.
bitrates. And you had before your graph showed you've got a very deep library,
yep.
so basically everything's watched. How often do you not get cache hits, and what sort of an impact does that have, especially when your clients are doing then alternating their requested bandwidth based upon what they detect?
Sure. So a couple of things. One thing we hope to change in the future, which is if a cache has one bitrate that a client might be requesting, it'll have all of them. And that was an early on decision that we thought it would, the client teams thought that that would be the best behavior, because if you're on a particular bitrate and you're worried about like your buffer underrunning, you would drop to a lower bitrate that you already knew you had a connection open, you could. Turns out that's probably not all that important, and it's very bad from a cache efficiency point of view. We waste about twice the disk space because of that. And so we're moving to a model that won't be the case. But to answer your earlier question, you put in two caches and we stripe the content. So the content partitioning knows about not only individual machines but clusters of machines. And so 10 of our newest incarnation of storage servers can hold more than 2 petabytes of content, so we can put a whole library on that.
Yes, it might be interesting to mention how for popular content we have to have many copies of
it. Yeah, sure. And so across that storage layer, the most popular stuff we've duplicated across those servers. But then on the flash devices and on the flash on the spinning drive, we put the most popular content as well, all trying to stop like a single bit of hot content burning up a spindle and making a machine sort of run out of gas as such, when it's got a lot of actual CPU and network throughput capability, but the storage is the bottleneck.
So a lot of ISPs already, like, we have a couple of racks just for Netflix.
It really depends. It depends on their topology. Some
so just to have that amount to keep caches low.
Yes, if you're a very large ISP, you've got like, you know, hundreds of thousands of subs in a market that your topology is that a single location, then we would put in, you know, a rack of equipment.
And what do you do with all the RAM? Are you loading any of that content into like RAM disks or anything like that?
We have some, a lot of the RAM is used to sort of pre-read. So when we do a disk read, we want to try and make make the spindle move as efficient as possible. We also are starting to experiment with different ways of actually using it as a cache for the most popular content. So again, when something became super popular, even on a spinning drive system, it should start to become solely on the RAM. As you saw, like the newest configuration of Flash has quite a lot of RAM. It's always cheaper to buy the RAM and then work out how to do something better in software later than try and throw out all the servers and buy more.
My question is more about hardware.
Sure. Yeah, so the that's what the chassis looks like. This was a hardware guy put together a stop motion movie. Because we wanted to have that very high density. So one of the things when you look at high density server chassis, they're nearly always hot swap because they're in data center environments and people are worried about hard drives failing and they're storing content that's really important. Yeah, just talk to Lawrence later.
It's voice required.
So one of the compromises we did make is we wanted to have a very compact chassis, but we were totally willing to make it non-hot swappable. And so it's a custom chassis we've had made by a couple of different manufacturers. And in the quantity we make them, it doesn't add a significant amount of cost. It's a little of an extra aggravation because you have to sort of be the product person for a chassis and you don't really want to do that. But there's companies that make servers that have these sort of services and they have, you know, thermal chambers that they can go and test them in, and that's like worked out relatively well for us. Absolutely. So our firmware team is 8 people now, I think. So yeah, we have a whole bunch of people on staff that know how to build a system, and you know, in particular for the storage, we're using, again, you know, they're off the shelf, but there's still 16-way PCI SATA connectors. They cost some extra money. The drivers aren't necessarily great to start with, so we hired the guy that wrote the driver, and he makes it better. It's really great.
But a lot of kernel development work, the only job is to get stuff off and drive it onto the
thing. Yeah. I would say our experience was very quickly we got a system that worked relatively well. But you know, the hardware was a little different, but it still had 36 drives. We were able to push 5 gigs within a few weeks. But now we can do close to 20, and that's taken a couple of years of extra optimization. It's obviously very valuable for us. We have this equipment out in the field already. It's all incremental goodness, and you get more throughput.
How many disks fail in each box before you replace it?
So we would say that we would replace it probably after about 10. We've never replaced a system in the 3 years that we've had systems in the field. So we definitely see some failures, but never enough to justify pulling it out. And you'd think after 3 years, we'd just put in new devices and such. Yeah, a way of thinking about remote hands is we don't use them at all. And so it's more like, you know, a bit of consumer electronics, it fails. If you're buying some fancy bit of electronics, the company's likely to ship you a brand new one, and then you put your old one in the box that the first one came in and send it back again. And that's the sort of model we have, and that can work for us because we see very low failure rates and we want to keep the customer experience as nice as possible for the ISP. But again, that's happened very rarely. You mean filling the caches or the caches to the end users?
Across the network itself, so coming out of the caches going towards the client.
Right.
Is it really bursty, or does it tend to be fairly smooth once they've started watching a show? Because I don't tend to think about interaction with streaming Netflix TV show over in via my home broadband,
right,
my own Wi-Fi, when somebody else wants to do a Skype call or somebody else is playing online.
Yeah, they shouldn't be doing that.
They should be watching Netflix.
The only problem we worry about is when they want to watch the second Netflix stream in the same room. It's a great question. We've looked at various interactions. I think, you know, it's an ongoing project to make that as good as possible. We definitely see and have historically seen a bunch of issues at interconnect points on, you know, between our caches and the end users. But there's sort of a wide open area of how good people's home Wi-Fi is, some of the issues around that. You know, one of the interesting statistics is a device like a PlayStation 3 has built-in Wi-Fi. The majority of people that stream using a PlayStation are using Wi-Fi. The people that plug it in get a much better experience, and like a noticeably better experience. And there might be some selection effect. The sort of people that know that they could plug it in and have it next to their home router might be, you know, more likely to pay for a better internet package or something. But there's definitely some quality loss from Wi-Fi, you know, and that's an area we're continually looking into. So a bunch of people on Wi-Fi will get the highest bit rate. I just mean in aggregate, we see like a decreased average bit rate when you look across, you know, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of different streams when it's wired versus unwired. And we've seen that in other devices. It's not a PlayStation specific thing. We've seen it in other devices as well, plugged in devices, whether it's an Apple TV or Roku box or smart TV. If it's not on Wi-Fi, it'll work slightly better. So there's definitely some improvements there, because Wi-Fi in principle should be just as good for most of our use cases.
And I guess we would characterize it as probably, you know, packet loss and latency from being too far away from the router and bad queuing behavior.
Actually, my question was kind of related to that. I guess you talked about this control plane between the client back to the central controller, if you want, for positioning content and fixing or improving quality. What that sort of assumes that you can't do anything about the network. The network's just there, a bit like what Randall was saying. In an ideal world, what, you know, do you, how much work do you do as Netflix on, or what would you like the network to be able to do for you to make things better, as opposed to just kind of being there to provide a shared, simple, basic infrastructure that you make use of?
I'm not sure this is directly answering your question, but I think a bunch of our customer service people are helping people debug their home network setup. And so there's obviously some cost associated with that. So if we could automate some of that and identify that, hey, looks like you might be using this sort of Wi-Fi setup, if you changed it to this one or whatever, you might get a better experience. Things like that would certainly help. But, you know, to a large extent, because we're such a ubiquitous service, we're going to have to deal with all these different environments, and so we want to just try and do the best that we can in any particular environment. I don't think we're going to have, you know, here you have this router, we recommend you download the Netflix router software on it, it will work much better.
This might be a business question, they try out of scope, but your entire infrastructure, does it tend to preclude you potentially branching out into almost live TV streaming in the future? How much, it seems to be predicated on the assumption that you can buffer everything out. Latency is really not a major issue to you.
Sure.
Do you have any thoughts about improving the architecture and getting into more live content?
Sure. So from a business point of view, we have no intention of doing live TV. But if we did, I think there would be certain changes we would make, but I think our existing hardware would do a fine job. I've done a bunch of live video before. Typically, it's like a sporting event or something like that, where you see a large amount of people watching the same thing. Like the instant replay thing, it's cool and it demos really well. Very few people actually typically use that sort of functionality, so nearly everyone on live stream wants to watch that particular part of the game. And so we can use, you know, memory for that in a great way. And latency because of the cost savings of moving the bits to different networks that that ISPs see. You know, as we build our network out, we're going to have really well-positioned infrastructure. And it's sort of interesting because, you know, you can stream Netflix from Australia, it turns out. And we don't have equipment in Australia. It's all coming out of LA or San Francisco. I can stream it off London, as an example, and it will work just fine. The latency isn't great, but the service is fine. But it's just because of the cost savings in that sort of ecosystem of networks that are the providers, that the infrastructure we build will be very appropriate for low latency stuff. So less in the live context, but at the moment, the box shots that show up in the user interface that I was showing at the beginning, we still use an external CDN for that because it's a totally different sort of design and we didn't want to deal with small objects and higher heat rates. And it's way less than 1% of our traffic. But we might at some point do it because we want a really even better user experience, and we have a better low latency connection to our clients just because, from a cost argument, we've got these boxes close by.
We might wrap it up there. So thank you once again, Doug. This has been a Swinburne production.